Hey guys, what's up? Thank you so much for tuning in today here at Elevate Church. We know that today's message is going to rock your world and elevate your life to the next level. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the message.
Look at this. In 3 John, John is speaking something that's very, very important for us to understand. He says, beloved, and we know that beloved means that you're the love of God. You are his precious prize. He loves you. He says, beloved, I pray that all may go well with you. Now, how many would love someone to pray like that for you? Man, I pray, CJ, that all would go well with you. Man, everybody would be like, oh, yes, I received that. That all. Wouldn't that be awesome that if just everything went well for you? This is what John's praying. He says, I pray that all would go well with you and that you may be in good health. Listen, everybody say good health. This is all going to tie in, but stay with me. That we would all be in good what? Health. That you may be in good health as it goes well with your what? So this verse is incredibly significant because what John is really saying is that you can only be as well as your soul. You can only be as well as your soul. And obviously, we know that the soul is so important. The soul is what's constantly being transformed and renewed, right? And so here you have John who is really wanting to begin to deal with the matter of the health. See, because you can be healthy on the outside, right? You can have muscles. You can be healthy in your eating habits. You can have a healthy career. You can have healthy, hairstyles, right? You have nice long hair. It's beautiful. You can be healthy on the outside, but John is not talking about the exterior health. He's talking about the inner health. He's talking about the soul. And if you understand, when John says, you know what, beloved, I pray that all may go well with you and that even your health would prosper, even as your soul prospers, basically saying that your soul, can you guys see this green marker? Y'all see that? Okay, your soul, right? Okay, which is made up of your mind, right? Stay with me. Will and emotions. You got that, youth? Good. Awesome. Thank you. I love the yeah. Just like youth. Yeah, we got it, man. So our soul, if we go back and read the verse, look, he's saying, beloved, I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your mind, as it goes well with your will, as it goes well with your emotions. And so John is saying, hey, listen, you can only be as well as your thoughts. You can only be as well as, what's will? What do you guys think will is? Choice? I would call it do. It's what I do, right? Because many of us want to lose weight, but will we lose it? Do. And then what's emotion? Feelings, right? It's what I feel. So John is saying, hey, listen, your health will prosper based on your thoughts, based on what you do, and based on how you allow your feelings to dictate. Do you understand what I'm saying? Stay with me. So John wants us to know that you can only be as well as you are on the inside. Why does he talk about this? I'll tell you why. Because John realizes that the church has become very toxic. And as people, we can become very toxic in our thinking. We can become very toxic in our will, right? What I'm willing or willing not to do. Am I willing to obey God? Am I willing not to obey God? We can become toxic in our feelings. All of a sudden, you have these feelings that you're basically putting all of your faith in. And how many know that you can't always trust what you feel? You can't always trust what you feel. Why? Because feelings are always subject to change. And so John is talking about the health of the soul. He's talking about the spiritual health of the church. And as I was just thinking about this, I started thinking about technology. That's why the name of this message is called Hate-nology. And the reason I'm calling it Hate-nology is because technology is a beautiful vehicle. I believe that technology is, it's a brutal thing. It's brutal, but it's beautiful. It's brutal because people have used technology for division, for hate, for lies, for deception. Technology has been used for a lot of wrong and toxic and evil things, right? There's pornography. It's been used for so many things that trafficking, so many things that technology has been used for. But how many know that technology is also a beautiful thing? Because technology is something that you can share your life from another country, from another state. You can share memories, stories. You can share pictures, and you can share moments with family, etc. So technology is not a bad thing. But let's be honest. Technology has also literally has framed and formed our culture and our society today. If you think about it, now the centerpiece of every single table in America is a cell phone. When we go to dinner, what's the first thing that we all do? Mom and dad, we do the same thing too. And then you see, and then go to the restaurants, look around, you just see everybody like this. Right? Everyone's like this, right, youth? Right? Who wants to eat dinner when you can be on your, you know, Snapchat, Instagram, Facebook? Well, Facebook is for old people. But your Twitter, if you're only on Facebook, I'm talking to you. It's true. They say that Facebook is for, like, you know, the 30s and up. And then Instagram is for 30s and below. And then Twitter's Twitter. Yeah. And so here's what I started thinking. So what does all this mean? How do you go from John to, you know, your soul? Here's why. And I really feel like this is a revelation from heaven. I believe that social media has become the mirror of our soul. You know why? It's become the mirror of our soul because on social media, you always communicate your thoughts. On social media, you always communicate what you do. And on social media, you always communicate your feelings. They even have emojis now that you can put on there. It's so funny how so many people, especially the Christian church, puts all these different emojis. I'm angry. And they got these little emojis that anger, like, dude, why do we want to know you're angry? But the reality is this, is that technology has totally taken complete control of our culture and our society today. Without even knowing it, we are already being shaped and formed into the society and the culture that that's been created with this social media, which, once again, it's beautiful, but it's also dangerous. It has fashioned our children. Parents are no longer raising kids. Social media is. We're keeping our babies busy. Now you go into houses, friends, stuff. Don't you always see the little baby, two-year-old baby already on the iPad? They got their own iPads. My sister bought my little nieces and nephews. They all have their own iPads. I'm like, dang. And they all have their own shows, and they know how to push every button. And it's like, wow, you know what? I should hook them up with some grandparents, teach them how to use the iPad, right? I mean, two-year-olds already know where to go for their shows. Three-year-olds. So it's powerful, okay? It's beautiful, but it's also been very brutal. And the reason I wanted to talk about this today is because, yes, technology is a tool for especially the gospel, for us to get the word of God out. It's done a lot of awesome things. But technology has also been a very ugly thing. You know, there's all kinds of, you know, kids have committed suicide because of technology, because of cyberbullying. You know, lies have been made about people, and families have been destroyed because of comments and statements that people have made. And we have to know the origin of all this, guys. We have to know the origin of everything that has taken place right now in our culture is nothing but division. There's a lot of hate in social media. You see what happened in South Carolina, and you see just everywhere. Something happens. Everybody gets on the bandwagon, and everybody starts putting in their little two cents. You know, we see what just happened right now in Houston, which, by the way, we're partnering with Fellowship Church, and we are going to financially support the cause in Houston, and we'll talk more about that at the end of the service. But I want you to know that while people are dying, while people have lost everything. Today I was talking to my brother-in-law, and I checked up on him because his sister lives in Houston. They lost all three cars and their home. They're still sleeping in their home right now with 2 feet of water in their house, but their house is two stories, so they're sleeping on the second floor, and it's horrible. While these people are losing homes and cars and pets and family, you have goofy, toxic Christians jumping on the bandwagon of social media, talking crap about a church named Lakewood Church with Joel Osteen, and nobody knows this guy. Nobody has ever sat with him. No one has ever done life with him. No one knows the ins or the outs of what's happening there, but it's so amazing how many toxic and small-minded believers and Christians get on the bandwagon and start talking smack because such and so. It's called secondhand offense, which we always see in the church. Secondhand smoke kills more people than firsthand smoke. Let me tell you something, Christians. Secondhand offense kills more than the first person who was offended. Watch the secondhand offense. And so you have all these people that are just hearing all these different things about, and why doesn't that church do something? And why isn't that church? You know what I think sometimes? I'm thinking, man, the worst people that's doing all this is not even the world talking smack about. Actually, the world is backing up Joel Osteen right now while the Christians are bashing him. The world is saying, wait a minute, you've been here for 60 years. We know your father. You've always been a part of this community. You know what, guys? You have to be careful because the whole world is watching how the Christians will respond to tragic situations like this. They're watching us. The world is watching you. When you are posting something on social media, they're watching you. Everyone is watching us. Everyone wants to see us go down. Everyone wants to see us mess up. Everyone wants to put us on notice. Everybody wants to see, but that's the wrong spirit. That's a spirit of division. Jesus said this. He said, a house divided will not stand. And so how can we stand against all the hell, the brutal stuff that happens? We got to stay united. There has to be a spirit of unity. There has to be a spirit of oneness. There has to be a spirit of we fight the good fight of faith together. Amen. And so I have to talk about this because a lot of this stuff that's coming out in social media, youth, let me tell you something, it's coming out of your soul. Social media, it's a fantasy. Why? Let me say this, because I was talking to Lexi, and I was just kind of getting her input. I'm like, Lexi, do you think I can keep the youth here tonight? She's like, yeah. And I'm like, I told her, here's how I'm going to talk about hateology. And she's like, okay. And then I started explaining. She just started going off. I'm like, dang, this girl's like anointed. I'm like, I should have you preach this message. But she said, Pastor, she's like, you know what? All they do is people always just post the good stuff. You know, it's like, you know, youth, just think about this. You know, all your friends, they're always just trying to just like, you know what, show something off, right? Like, you know, look at me. I got a new boyfriend. And they get all excited. And they're just like, and their picture's all up. But here's how, why don't people show a picture like when you break up? Like, why not show a picture like why don't we show, or you take a picture, it's my new ride. Yeah, why don't you take a picture when your car's broke down on the freeway? Like, you know what, here's my clunker, you know what this is. Right? I mean, you think about this, you know, or you got this a lot. Ladies, please don't do this. Okay, this is, it's annoying because then you have to like, it's like you can't even, you know, you're trying to slide through your stuff. You know, it's like, you know, guys and girls, they're like half naked. And they're like, oh, look at the sunset. And it's like them on a bathing suit, butt naked. It's like, yeah, so true, right? Yeah. Or you're on this beautiful vacation and you're like, oh, isn't God so good? No, you're humble bragging. We have to be careful. Some of you are like, Dan, I need to go back home and take off all of my. No, but it's true. Listen, without even knowing it, do you know, let me tell you something. The pride of life comes in. And it's no longer about anybody else. Listen, this social media world has made it about me. Do you know that the word selfie came out of this movement of technology? Oh, I'll take it further. You see, Satan knew all about selfie before selfie was ever created. Can I take you to a Bible verse? Okay, let's go to the Bible. Okay, are you guys here tonight? I know this is a very everywhere message, but I like it. It's 1:15, right? That's what we call the service, 1:15. Check this out. Look at this. Satan was on Snapchat. He was on Instagram, Facebook, and he was tweeting stuff. And he tweeted in Isaiah 13:14, he tweeted this. Check this out. He said, you said in your what? Okay, let me tell you something. Another definition of soul is heart. Okay? You said in your soul. Everybody say soul. You said in your soul, look at this. I will go up to the heavens. And then he took a little picture right there, selfie in the heavens. Everybody say I. I'll raise my throne above the stars of God. Then he took a picture by the stars. Are you there? I'll sit as king on the mountain. And he was on the mountains where the gods meet. I'll set up my throne on the highest slopes of Mount Zaphon. I will rise above the tops of the clouds. I'll make myself like the Most High God. Come on, technology has the big I, me, I, me. Look at me, look at I, me, I went, me went, they went. And it's just, it's bad. This was the birth of selfie. And so today, it's just been covered up. It's just been all wrapped up. You listen, guys. When you see social media, please, it's so easy to begin to compare yourself to a life that you wish you had that you don't have. But no one has told you this. That was just a click moment. It wasn't the whole life. And it's amazing how many of us, we continue to do the same thing. We keep looking at all these images and these pictures and why is she so skinny and why is he so fit and why do they have that nice? But let me tell you something. Everything is just a snap, but no one knows the whole reel of every single issue of people's life. Those same people that look happy, most of them are empty shells. They're hurting. They're broken. They're busted. They're disgusted. They're all going through stuff just like you. And there's this fantasy, like, oh, my God, you know what? It's true, but it's funny. Everyone always looks for the right angle. Have you not? I've even said it when I tell the staff, like, all right, give me the best angle, Feli. And she always makes me, like, taller and thinner. You know, it's all about the angle, right? You know, okay, let's pretend like we're at our birthday party and there's hundreds of people. Okay, everybody just kind of just move around, move your head a little bit, and then they get the right angle. It's like, man, there was thousands of people here. That was like 10 people at your birthday party. Why are you acting crazy? But Satan has an angle as well. And he has an angle on how to get you. And he has an angle on how to get me. And it's called pride. And he's just waiting for us to fall into this trap of I, me. He wants to get our soul toxic. He wants to get the way we think. Because right now, everybody has an opinion. But let me tell you something. Just because you have an opinion doesn't mean that God has to put value on that. God has the final word, not you and me. Aren't you glad that he has the final word? The final authority is God, not you. But listen, social media has been so dangerous in the hands of toxic people who have been critical, judgmental, hateful, angry. I mean, stupid stuff like this. And I was going to bring a whole bunch, but then I'm like, I'm not going to give the devil even time to show people what it looks like. I'm going to give God all the time. But it's funny how people will just, you know, just bash on organizations. Like, I was reading a few, like, some people were smashing Doritos because, you know what, they support LGBT. Oh, you've lost the customer, Doritos. Oh, you dirty, perverted fools. Us Christians, we're persecuted. Oh, you just lost the customer. As if Doritos cares. A year from now, you'll be at Hawaii munching on a Dorito, not even know you're eating it. Right? I'll never shop here again. Next thing you know, you're right back there. And so we're so toxic in how we talk. We just talk. We just think, and just like we think whatever is on our mind at that moment, and we say what we think, and we don't really think about thinking about what we say. You know, or you see a post that you didn't like, and let's say you're the righteous one, and you're like, that's wrong. I need to say something about it. But you're no better than they are either. Because now you just got on the bandwagon, and the enemy went ahead and just lured you in. Are you guys here tonight? Yeah. I know it's good. So you have to be careful that you don't get wrapped up in this, because here's what happens. Since the beginning, Satan has been an accuser. Look at this. In Revelations 12:10, it says, for the accuser of our brethren who accused them before our God day and night has been cast down. You have to understand that anytime you and I start talking smack about an organization, people, or a church, you're no different than Satan himself. You're no different. Pastor, what do you mean? You're calling me Satan? Maybe. Maybe. I mean, if the devil can dress up as a wolf in sheep's clothing, I don't know what you can do. Right? I mean, come on. Who here has ever been offended at a post? Let's be honest. Keep it real. You've been offended at a post. Don't lie in church, please. We've all have. Everyone here has been offended at a post, or you saw something that made you angry, like, oh, how dare they? You know, but here's the deal. Who made you judge? Well, Pastor, the Bible says you are to judge sin. Yeah, but you're looking at everything. Everything's sin for you. So it's the spirit that's behind you. It's the attitude, it's the thought, it's what's going on in my mind, what's going on in my emotions, what am I thinking about this whole situation? Because you know what, I don't want to become like the accuser, because the Bible says since the beginning there was an accuser of brethren. Why do we want to get wrapped up accusing people of things that you don't even know? It's amazing how many people get offended and don't have the whole story down. Everybody likes to attack or criticize a leader until they have to lead. Are you here tonight? Yes. Matthew 7, look at this. Look at this. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. Dang, that's Jesus in the red. He said, you want to talk smack? Okay. It's coming to you. This is a warning. This is in the red, guys. This is Jesus says, hey, listen, every time you go around and you gossip and slander, every time you go around and you whisper little things when you're hanging out with your friends, wait for it, because it's coming back to you. So the same measure that you use to judge another person is the same measure that it's going to come back to you. It's just a matter of time. You see, nobody stops slandering because God's not throwing down lightning bolts on anyone. And so because nothing's happening, we keep doing it. And so here he says, for in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure that you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? Dang, a plank. He goes from speck to plank. Wow. Like what? Like, why are you talking about your brother's little speck? When you got this big old, this log coming out of your eyeball, right? You're just like, why are you doing this? And he says, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. Everybody say, you hypocrite. Somebody don't want to say it because, I don't know. Say it with me. You hypocrite. Man, this is, Jesus didn't play no jokes here, man. He was firm. You hypocrite. So what is he saying? He's saying anytime that you judge, you're a hypocrite. Anytime you slander, you're a hypocrite. Anytime you begin to gossip, you're a hypocrite. Anytime you go around and you think, humble brag, right? Like, hey, you know what? You know, so-and-so is doing, man, she's just dating some guy right now, and she's just like, you know, I think he's from the devil, you know. I just want to pray for her, you know, because, you know, Lord, open her eyes, Father. Just open her eyes, Lord. Open the eyes of her heart, Lord. I mean, you sing the song, you play the tune, and God, just open her eyes. Why don't we just apply the Matthew 18 principles? If you have aught against your brother or sister, go and find them and tell them, stay away from that dude because I know for a fact that he's doing X, Y, Z. Instead of going around to a group of people, let's all huddle together and let's just pray for Sister Joni because right now she's just dating a bad guy. Like, I'd rather just go to Joni and be like, hey, Joni, girl, watch it. What's wrong with you? You know he's a joker. What's wrong? Yes or no?
Yes.
You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. So there's nothing wrong with coming to someone saying, hey, there's an issue, but there is an issue when all you do is judge, judge, judge. Use the Matthew 18 principle. If there's an issue, you go talk to those people. Don't be the soapbox person. What's a soapbox person? You get on your little soapbox and now you want to have a voice. I know something. No. God says do everything without argument and without complaining. Why are we arguing? Why are we complaining about what others do? Who are we? We're toxic. And that's why John says, hey, listen, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you that you may prosper in all things. That you would prosper in your relationships, that you would prosper in your family, that you would prosper in the workplace. Come on, that you would prosper in your church, that you would prosper in this world, that people wouldn't have anything to say of you. How many know people that are just, they're like the company gossiper? Anybody have any company gossipers in where you work at? Like, man, that sister tell it all, right? And so you can have people that are just like, man, you already know, like, oh, no, here they come. And you already know what they're going to do. And so we really got to take these words of Jesus serious. And we can't get on the bandwagon of someone else's offense and cause more damage than there already is. Are you here? Okay. Let me give you 7 ways and how to behave. Online, I didn't give this to the media, but that's okay. Number 1, no soapbox. Philippians 2:14, just write that down. It says, do everything without arguing or complaining. Number two, no public bashing. No public bashing. But we should be supporting the Christian movement. That's, Doritos shouldn't do that. You know what? Doritos going to do what they're going to do. Okay, you're broke. They got money. They have money to market. You can do all your picket sign all you want. Listen, but why don't you do something more valuable with your time, like go win a soul for Christ. Like, let's go win souls for Jesus. Let's go change lives. Instead of talking about people, how about let's go save people? Let's go rescue some people that are hurting. Youth, you guys can go now. Go have your pizza party. Thank you guys for staying. You guys are awesome. Go, 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 because we're almost done. No public bashing. Listen, it never promotes peace. I can tell you that right now. It never promotes peace. Number three, no little jabs. Not even the little jabs. Don't do the little jabs, okay? We shouldn't say things about others that may be misinterpreted, okay? Just no little jabs. It's not even worth it. You have to guard your online tongue. Okay? Think. We all have an online tongue. Okay, so before you want to start typing it, maybe you should do this. If you really want to do it, just type it and then delete it. You know, just get it off your, and then in your mind you're going to think, I did it. And whatever, I don't know. Whatever makes you feel, whatever turns you on, okay? But just delete it afterwards, right? Just delete. Don't ever hit post. Just, and be like, and then just repent and then erase it and you're good. Number four. Encouragement. Use it to encourage people. When was the last time? Let me ask you this. When was the first time that you, instead of posting yourself, posted a few pictures of people that you love and just said something encouraging about them, and it wasn't another selfie of you? Look at me. Like, I double dog challenge all of you here. I challenge you tonight, find someone you love, post a picture of them and just say, let me tell you something. Let me tell you one awesome godly characteristic of this person. This person, man, is someone who loves hard. This person will give you the shirt off their back. This person is kind. What if we started doing that? Like, let's stop posting pictures of us. Selfies. Go back to your Instagram. If it's a lot of pictures of you, I'm talking to you. That was dangerous right there. Is that not true or not? I think people that are always posting pictures of themselves have an image issue. You just want everybody to tell you how pretty. You're so cute. Wow, you're so... Why? You need validation. Let me tell you something. God has validated you. You are awesome. You are magnificent. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. There's your validation. Amen? Are you guys mad at me? No, okay, good. Let me look at faces right now. Anybody mad at me? Okay. Number five, do to others as we would have them do to us. Remember this, the Bible says this, a soft answer turns away wrath. Why don't you be the soft answer and not be the wrath? Be the soft answer. Number six, guard against pride. I don't like posting pictures of my vacations. And I do that for a reason, because I know I get to go to awesome places, but why do I have to brag all about them? There's other people that would love to be at certain places. I don't like doing that. My family knows, don't post my private life. I don't like it. Leave my private life private. You know, periodically, maybe once, twice a year, I'll post something crazy, you know, like swimming with a shark or something, but that deserves an eye. I swam with sharks. Number six, guard against pride, okay? We have to be very careful with self-promotion and bragging about ourselves. Self-promotion is spiritual demotion. Number seven, Do not allow it to be a replacement for community. And so many of us, we say, I have friends. No, those are people that follow you on social media. They're not your friends. They don't even like you. The button just says like. You know what I'm saying? And so don't let that be the exchange for your community where you need to be around some people. God created us for a community. He created us for relationship. And relationship is what we need. We need to be around some people, hang out with some folks, and connect with some people, and you never know. I leave you off with this last verse, and we're done. Psalms 103, verse 1 says this. Look at this. I'm going to close it up. I'm going to put the little bow on it. Here's what David said. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is with what? Let's read this again. All together. 1, 2, 3. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within. Bless his holy name. Let's read that again. One more time. 1, 2, 3.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within. Bless his holy name.
We need to let everything that's within us bless everything that's outside of us. Stop cursing what God has blessed. The people you hate on right now, he blessed them. God says, I cover even the lily in the hills. He loves everyone. He hates sin, but he loves everyone. So who are we to judge? Who are we to judge?
If today's message impacted you in any way and you want to help us spread the gospel with a financial gift, text the number below. And we know that someone's life will be changed the same way that yours was today.